It's my honor and privilege to introduce our speaker to us this morning. Dr. Swindoll served Dallas Seminary as the fourth president and is known by millions around the world for his practical application of Bible teaching to everyday living. He now serves Dallas Seminary as its chancellor, and he is currently the senior pastor of Stonebriar Community Church in Frisco. Dr. Swindoll is the author of more than 90 books and is the featured Bible teacher on the popular radio program Insight for Living, and many of his colleagues are here this morning. That Insight for Living is aired around the world 2,000 times daily. Chuck and Cynthia, his partner in life and ministry, reside here in the Metroplex, and they love to spend time with their four grown children, their 10 grandchildren, and six great grandchildren. Would you please welcome with me Dr. Chuck Swindoll?
Good morning. To you brand new students, welcome. It's great that you're here. Don't let any of those people sitting around you turn you off for any reason, whatever. We're so glad you've chosen to come to Dallas Seminary, which is not a perfect place, but it's a better place now that you're here. And we're glad you're here to learn and to grow and discover and go through things that you never, ever dreamed you would go through, which is not a part of the curriculum that we put together, but it's part of God's curriculum. And a special welcome to my friends from Insight for Living, who have heard everything I've ever had to say. And they are here acting like they're hearing it for the first time. Did Colleen make the trip? Not able to come. Our daughter is in that department. I want to interview her for a moment, which is probably the reason she didn't come this morning. Anyway, glad you're here. And I mean that sincerely. Mark Toby is the leader of the department. And thank you for being here, Mark. When I first came back to the seminary, Mark was on duty here and was involved as sort of my personal associate, helped me, kind of helped write letters for me and would put them together, and we kind of teamed up in that way, and he cleaned up my stuff and made me sound better than I ever would normally have sounded. So I'm not sure I ever thanked you for that, Mark. And especially, we never say this to our faculty, as if you're all sitting here. Maybe there are some of you sitting elsewhere, but thank you for being here, and thank you for your investment in the lives of these students, and for hanging in there year after year, doing what you do, acting like you love doing it. Thank you for that. I know you do. And especially thank you for your patience. As year after year, you teach students, often you're the last ones to know how much you mean to them. And today, I want to speak as a student and tell you that because of the faculty of this school, the whole direction of my life was rearranged. And you became for me, some of you who were here when I was here, became mentors and longtime friends. And how grateful I am. And I'm really not blowing smoke when I say that. I really mean it. I have a friend who couldn't sleep one night, and it was a choice of either reading one of my books or watching a boring television program. So he chose the latter. And as a result, of all things, rather than it being boring, like the old C-SPAN used to be, where you'd watch you know, congressional meetings, and it all stand around talking about stuff until it was just unbearable. This happened to be a scene that was taken in a rather unusual room. It was a room filled with brand new citizens of these United States. How great is that? To have on film the moment after they've taken the oath and they're now waving little American flags and all excited about becoming brand new citizens. Many of them had been here for years and they had studied and worked for that moment. And so this reporter who was sort of roving among the group had a cameraman with him. And he stopped at one man that was sort of alone without a family around him. And he said to him, it looked like he may have been from Vietnam. And he said to this Asian fellow who was getting up in years, is this just the happiest and most fulfilling moment of your life? And the man responded rather seriously, actually, no, it isn't. Hey, he didn't mean to be cynical. He just was going to be honest and say, and it was as if he had prepared the classic answer for that question. It was almost like a setup. He said, if I want to be happy and really fulfilled for an hour, I'd take a nap. If I want to be really fulfilled for a day, I'd go fishing. If I wanted to be happy and fulfilled for a week, I'd take a nice vacation. If I want to be happy and fulfilled for a month, I'd get married. If I wanted to be happy and fulfilled for a year, I'd need to inherit a lot of money. But if I want to be happy and fulfilled for a lifetime, I'd need to get a great education. How's that for an answer, huh? You who are students at this place do not have any idea how fulfilling it will be to be engaged in what you are studying to become, whatever that may be. You don't even know that. Most who come and study at our school think they have a pretty good idea. Some admittedly say they don't know where the Lord's going to use them, but they really feel this is where they ought to be for now. But some come sort of locked in. We know we're going to be engaged in this, and you're probably not. You're in for a surprise because God's got a truckload of those surprises waiting for you. And I can assure you, I had no clue. No clue. I came, I was scared spitless when I got here. I thought I'm going to be around all these brilliant men. At that time, we were all men. And I thought, yeah, this is going to blow me away. I did have a few very bright friends and colleagues at the school here. But I want to tell you, it wasn't long before I realized we were all on the same level at the foot of the cross. Some had IQs that were soaring. They could get the stuff and get it quick, and they learned it, and they just aced the courses. Others of us really worked at that. And I realized as I was about to leave, I realized the value of preparing. the importance of putting down healthy, wholesome roots so that I would be a perpetual student of the scriptures. And I want to tell you, that is what is on my heart this morning. My last semester, in our last semester here, I talked about how to ruin your time at the school. Some of you will remember that. And we addressed things like cynicism and a bad attitude and other things. Worry, which is such a joy stealer. But this semester, these few times I have the privilege of speaking, I want to talk about how to enhance your days at this school, your years. And by the way, finish. That's a good thing to remember as you start. Finish. Stay at it. Determine, regardless of how long it takes you. I remember when I was handing out degrees and or diplomas, and we would have different, you know, students come by, they'd whisper different things as they were graduating. One PhD student, gray hair sticking out under his cap. He needed a haircut, actually, sticking out under his cap. And probably didn't have time to get one. Anyway, I found out later that I think he said he was 80 years old, said to someone, leaned over and he said to me, 12 years. But I finished. I salute that kind of person. Your years of preparation, regardless of how long, there's no shame in how long it takes you. Your years are worth every single moment, every sacrifice, every tough day, every sick day, every disappointment, every hardship. It's worth it. Listen to someone who's been through it. And now from the other side, I look back and I'll tell you, Scout's Honor, there is not a day that, I'll say a week. There's not a week that passes that I don't give God thanks for my training at this school. This imperfect place filled with imperfect faculty members, things you could pick apart if you want to pick apart, but still a place that helped prepare me for a lifetime. So if you want to enhance your years at Dallas Seminary, think of being a perpetual student of the scriptures. And you're learning right here the first steps involved in that. C.S. Lewis said, if you give me 10 minutes to chop down a tree, I'll spend my first 2 minutes sharpening my axe. You're sharpening your axe. Donald Gray Barnhouse, whose name was a household name in Christian circles back in the 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s as I was growing up, Donald Barnhouse said, if I had only 3 years to serve my Lord, I'd spend 2 of them studying. Billy Graham was interviewed not long ago at one of his birthdays. Isn't it great how long he's living? Isn't it terrific, this prophet with honor? He was interviewed and asked if you had anything you could do differently in your life, what would it be? He didn't take but a couple of seconds before he answered. And I quote, I would have studied more and preached less, at least 3 times more than I had done. That's Billy Graham. I would have prepared better. I would have spent longer getting really solid in my roots, theologically, academically, prepared better. There's a Chinese proverb that says, dig the well, before you were thirsty. You're digging the well. You'll never dig it again. Your first year is the only first year here for the rest of your life. Your second year, the only one you'll have here for the rest of your life. Don't live to get over it. Live to drain from it every bit it can provide for you. Dig into the books that are given as assignments. Listen to those lectures that are set forth. Look closely at the work before you. Attend gatherings where there are people like Alistair Begg to come here. I mean, it's coming to you. What a privilege to be able to listen to a man of that stature, with that experience, willing to live in Cleveland. I mean, that alone is going to be rewarded with great eternal rewards. What a great guy. I want to look at Joshua 1 with you, and we're going to draw from it some things that I think will help us drive that point deeper. But I assure you, when we turn, there are no 90-day wonders in ministry. There are no miracle boy preachers. That's kind of weird to come across a boy preacher. You want to be known as an expositor. You want to build a reputation that's based on this book. You want to be known as a student of the Word of God. You want to be a reliable source of hope and help for people who are struggling, trying to make it through life. And they don't know what you know. And they come to you not needing your opinions. They need to know, what does this say to me? If this is God's eternal word, how can I link up with it? Let me tell you something. You won't know what to tell them if you don't dig in right now and from here on. I was up at 4:15 yesterday morning, a day off, a holiday, digging in to Matthew chapter 17 because I'm in it next Sunday. I'm speaking to a congregation that has been a part of my life for 18 years. They're not waiting to hear little ditties. They're waiting to see what Matthew 17, 22 to the end of the chapter is saying. It's my job to be prepared for that, to dig that well and to dig it carefully so that I'm not hitting from the hip. I'm helping them know what that is saying. So it requires diligence and discipline. Now, you don't have to go to seminary to prepare. You don't have to know Hebrew and Greek, though if you do, you will be better prepared. You don't have to come to Dallas Seminary, although if you do, you'll be better prepared. You don't have to spend years in academia, but if you do, you'll be better prepared. Because here you'll learn the world of literature that's available. You'll learn how to investigate on your own. You'll learn how to study meanings, backgrounds, the kind of things that people who are growing in the Lord long to know, but they're not equipped to know. You will be equipped. And so when we turn to this book of Joshua, we're turning to a man who has one horrendous task: to step into the sandals of a man who had meant the world to his congregation of people, Moses. read the last chapter of Deuteronomy, and you'll get just a glimpse of the man whose place Joshua was to take. What a man. What a series of experiences. And Joshua has been in preparation. I don't know if you thought about this, but for 40 years. For 40 years, he's been an assistant, watching, learning, studying, seeing Moses in his best and worst times, gleaning from all of that what would help him in the years ahead. Finally, age 120, his mentor dies. And there's a 30-year mourning period. And then we read, it came about after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord. There's no greater compliment. And the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' servant, and said, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, they've been mourning for 30 days. So this wasn't to inform Joshua of something he didn't know. It was to remind Joshua of something that's easy to forget. Moses is gone. You're on. I think it was Tozer who said, when a man of God dies, nothing of God dies. Moses filled the gap for those last 40 years, the best years of his life. God bless him. 80 to 120. Now there's a goal for life, huh? And what he did and what he saw and what he went through and that last shot when he gives those sermons that are filling the book of Deuteronomy, man, he could preach right to the end. And then he dies. He's dead. In your future, you quite likely will step into the shoes of someone who has had the respect of those people you'll be serving. I've had the experience in my own life. I followed Bruce Waltke when I went to New England. He had been there for a summer. And I don't know of anybody in that field of study I admired more than Bruce Waltke. And I stepped in after he had left. In fact, he recommended that they interview me to come to that little church. What a job. Bruce Waltke is gone. You're on. Before then, I'd served alongside Dwight Pentecost. I give you these stories because this was what I would have never expected. I graduated, had four opportunities. One was in Toledo, Ohio. One was in Chattanooga, Tennessee. Another one was in Castro Valley, California. And the fourth one was to stay here in Dallas and to serve alongside Dr. Pentecost. I'd already been in Grace Bible Church, and I thought, well, Cynthia's carrying our second child. It would be a real adjustment to move. I'm not ready for a pastorate. I got a lot of edges that need to be smoothed off, which has been the story of my life. And Dr. Pentecost is a patient man, lot of years of experience, loved and respected by this flock. It's a healthy place. I think I'd like to stay right here. And Dr. Pentecost was so gracious. And I was there ultimately 6.5 years. I'm grateful I was for those years. And when he was gone, I was on. You should have seen the faces of the people when I came in and realized Dr. Pentecost wasn't preaching that day. Who's preaching? Swindoll? Who's that? I gave it everything I had every time I preached, realizing Dr. Pentecost is gone. I'm on. It's my responsibility. And Joshua had to realize that. They've mourned for Moses, but Moses is dead. Now he's on. And the beautiful thing is, the Lord spoke to Joshua, just as he had spoken to Moses. Moses, my servant, is dead now. Therefore, arise, cross the Jordan, you and all this people, to the land I'm giving you. I have it all planned, Joshua. This is so good. Makes me want to laugh when I realize God had it all mapped out. Joshua knew none of it when he started this training under Moses. But he was all part of his preparation. Look at verse 3. Every place on which the sole of your foot treads, I've given it to you. Just as I spoke to Moses. Look at it. You're missing nothing. Moses had my voice and leadership. You've got my voice and my leadership. When I went to Irving Bible Church, I took the place of Dr. Stan Toussaint. A remarkable man. Today he suffers from a stroke. And he's now had his voice taken from him as a result of it. Is there anything worse than that? Well, it certainly could be worse, but to have your voice gone when you've made your whole life around your teaching ministry, and now he can't get his words out. But I was there when he could. And then he left, and then I came. And I will never forget the things I had to learn there. In that little church, as we began to grow, no one was more encouraging than Stanley Toussaint, saying to me, you know, God's in this. The Lord's going to guide you. He's going to use you. So I'm sure there were things like that that came into Joshua's mind. Verse 4, from the wilderness of this Lebanon, even as far as the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, as far as the great sea toward the setting of the sun will be your territory. You got it, man. I'm the giver of land. I'm the conqueror of people. I'm the leader of servants. Count on me. Walk with me. Let's do this. Joshua's got the inauguration happening right here. No one will be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Just as I've been with Moses, I'll be with you. Hot dog. Is there any promise better than that? I've been with him all these years, and now I'll be with you. Part of the reason Joshua could step into it is that he was well prepared. I'm hammering away at that because that's what these years are all about for you. And if you're not careful, you'll focus more on getting out than you will on digging in. You'll have your mind in the wrong place. Just get by. Get those words out of your mouth. Out of your mind. Never just get by. You don't want to take one course from a faculty member that wants to just get by. You want her or him to pour themselves into your life in a way that is contagious. And it impacts you. You know what? Every mentor I've ever had has been a great lifelong student of God's word, every one of them. And when I was with them, they were still learning from, studying, memorizing, teaching, preaching from this book. What great models they were. All of them very human, all of them imperfect. But all of them men of God that had marked my life. And Moses had been that to Joshua. And so he says in verse 6, a statement that he repeats now several times. Verse 6, only be strong and courageous, for you shall give this people possession of the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. But remember who gives it to them. I'm the giver of land. You just are the one that tells them about the plan. You don't take the glory for this. You don't get the credit for this. It's a great time for me to add a little extra for no extra charge. I really want you to get your full education here, and then I really want you to get over it. It's really important that you get over it. You know, if you earn your doctorate, great. That's terrific. Get over it. You know, don't put doctor on every note you write. Doctor, schmatz. Doctor. Okay. The only one that's important to is you. Give your spouse gratitude for putting up with you as you got through it. To God be the glory. Great things He does. Get out of the way. I don't want anybody leaving next Sunday talking about me. I want them talking about Jesus. That they came in touch with the Savior. Joshua, tell them about the land. Remind them I'm the one that gives them the land. Lead them into victory. Remind them I'm the victor. Keep your eyes on me, Joshua. You've lived through those 40 years where you wandered with those people who lost the focus on me. Imagine all the graves that were dug in the wanderings in the wilderness. Don't ever forget that, Joshua. Be strong and courageous. Look at 7. Only be strong and very courageous, careful to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. There it is again. Now, in this case, it's obedience. There's another line I could camp on. You never get so powerful or important that you don't need to be obedient. And obedience requires humility. It requires listening. It requires changing. It requires adapting. Obedience means you don't get your way. When the Lord directs your steps, you don't go where you're going to be comfortable. He's the one calling the shots. He's the one leading you. Joshua, be careful to do according to all that I've written. Don't turn from the left to from the right to the left so that you may have success wherever you go. Success. Wow. There's a word that's overworked. I like Churchill's statement. Success is going from failure to another failure without loss of enthusiasm. When I went to Wheaton College, had the privilege of bringing a spiritual life week there, I said to the chaplain, I'm going to talk on the F word. I thought he was going to pass out when I told him. I said, no, I'm going to talk on failure. He said, in all of my years at this school, I've never heard one message on failure. All my kids hear is that you're the Harvard among Christian colleges. I'm so sick of hearing that. Tell them about it. And I did. And you cannot believe the response. My granddaughter was there at the time. And she said, Bubba, you just wouldn't believe the kids in the dorm as they talked about that. Most of them have never thought of failing. Do you know, I don't believe I ever heard the word when I was a student here. Well, I want to give the word to you today. You're going to fail. You're going to make messes. You're going to do what's wrong. You don't want to. You dread the thought of it. I know. It's not something to be proud of, but it's a fact that it's a part of staying humble. I'm going to tell you the greatest response is to acknowledge it, admit it, don't hide it, say it as soon as you can, and then if it's been an offense, make it right. Because success will come to those who do what's right, who love mercy, and who, what? Walk humbly with their God. Walk humbly with your God. Be known as one who will acknowledge wrong when you are wrong. I plead with you. You are never so significant that you are not in need of confessing to someone you've hurt that you were wrong in hurting them. Live in such a way that when you wake up in the morning, you don't drag any anchors. As far as I'm able to tell, I don't believe that I've hurt anyone that I haven't tried to make it right or made it right. I don't believe I have. Finally, I learned that. And I learned to stop blaming, which is a great lesson that has another story to it I won't get into. But success is up to God. He'll take care of that part. You take care of the failures, because they're going to come. And they're not the end. They may be the beginning of something great when you learn how to handle the obstacle of failure. And then the verse I really had planned to camp on, but don't have time. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, 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 year after year, decade after decade, church after church, sermon after sermon, council after council, day and night, day and night, that you may do according to all that is written in it. For then you'll make your way prosperous, and then you'll have my kind of success. Cultivate the reputation for being a person of the Word of God. Make certain that when you minister, you are pointing them to what God has said and explaining what God means and then applying how it affects your life and theirs. And I'm telling you, people will love you for it. Now, a few won't, so what? Those that matter will. And when your life is beginning to be, when their lives are beginning to be changed, they won't have the words to describe how grateful they are. And I don't mean flattery. I despise flattery. I mean a genuine head on your shoulder telling you, you got me through a broken marriage. You got me through a child that I buried. You helped me get through an absolute breakdown. It was the most humiliating experience of my life. You got me beyond a moral failure. You got me through. You got me through. Really, it was God that got him through, but he used his word through your lips. And it all went back to my preparing to do what I do for the rest of my life. It all started here, right here. Front row, every chance I got. I got so close the prof spit on me. I was right down front. Couldn't get enough. Drank it in. Said to Cynthia time after time, I cannot believe how privileged we are to be here. Of all places for the Swindolls to wind up. You believe they accepted me here? And I had the privilege of sitting in this classroom and in these chapels and singing these hymns and learning them by heart. Like a river glorious, and can it be? I remember Dr. Sumi teaching us those, and he would walk up and down the platform, and he would be, you know, singing them. He'd always get in before the note hit. Oh, I mean, we were not there yet, but he'd go, oh, we'd get right into it. It was like, good night. I love that man. He didn't care what you thought. He was worshiping, and I saw it. Even as he held his arms out far enough for his sleeves to leave, and I saw the little loop, he called it, that loop of life, since he was on dialysis several times a week. I went to see him before I went to California, and I said, I got to stop. This is it. I've got to stop. I've got to stop with this. I went to see him, and I said, Dr. Sumi, I'm feeling guilty because I've got a possibility of going to a church in California. I don't want to go to California. And things are going so great here in Irving. I'm finally learning how to do it. And he said, well, is God calling you to California? And I thought, that's a great question. Why didn't I think of that? So I said, yes, sir, I think he is. He said, Chuck. Then I saw that loop. That blood flowing through that loop. He said, every day of my life, I'm looking at life or death right there on my wrist. I'm telling you, he said, if God's calling you to go, don't even hesitate. But if you go, stay. I'll never forget that. Okay, got it. And I stayed. 23 years. Whew. Several years along, I thought maybe God's leading me. And I remember hearing Sumi's voice, stay. And I did. And there's something gained by staying. Boy, did I learn by staying. And of all things, I wind up coming back here. You believe that? Can you believe that? And I thought, where's Sumi? Well, he had died by then, so I never say. So I thought, could God be leading me back here? He's certainly not. And my wife said, he may. I go, whose side are you on? I don't fit that place. There's a bunch of brains there. She said, no, they need a shepherd. They don't need more brains. So I thought, I think that's a compliment. I told you lately how much I adore the woman I married 61 and a half years ago. She was 12, I think. No, she was really young. That's another story. Dear Father, keep us faithful. Help us to get rid of all the restlessness and all the hurry up and all the push to get out there and to settle in here and to give this our very best. All these years. And may we have that kind of commitment that Dr. Sumi had. And may it grip us. And hold us close to you so that we are well prepared to do it for the rest of our lives. In the process, Lord, open these blind eyes that we might see the truth you have for us, and open our hearts that we might do what we see, so that we might make a difference in this generation and the world to come. In the name of Jesus. Everybody said,